This is another NMR problem. It's from fall of 2010 as well. And I'm going to still be using this same seven-step method that I used in the earlier problem. All right, so the first thing we want to do is look at the molecular formula and figure out how many double bond equivalents we have. C11, H14, O2. The oxygen is not going to play into the formula here. So it'd be C11H14. Now we'll see what it is. If it was saturated, it'd be C11H24. That's 11 times 2 plus 2 is 24. Double bond equivalents. It's going to be 24. Minus 14 divided by 2 equals 5. So we've got 5 double bond equivalents. That immediately makes me think that we've got an aromatic ring that's going to take up 4 double bond equivalents. That's 3 double bonds in a ring, and then one other double bond or ring somewhere outside the compound, or somewhere outside this ring. All right, so now we can figure out what we're actually going to see in the spectrum. That's this step here. Identify the pieces that can be seen. We've got a 5H, and it's between 7 and 8 ppm. That means that 5H is in the aromatic region. That tells me I've got an aromatic ring with 5 hydrogens on it. If I've got 5 hydrogens on the ring, that's only going to leave one space for anything else to be connected to it. So we're talking about a monosubstituted aromatic ring. All right, so just one thing connected to the ring. Next one, we've got a 3H. That 3H is a CH3. And now we've got CH2, CH2, and another CH2 down here. All right, so those are all the pieces that we can see in the compound from the spectrum. All right, now we're going to take the original molecular formula, and I'm going to now subtract out everything that I can see. Now the ring can be shortened out to C6H5, that's 6 carbons and 5 hydrogens. Now we've got a CH3 and a CH2 and a CH2 and a CH2. And what we're going to be left with now will be, let's see, we've got 11 carbons here, that's 6, and 4 is 10, so there's 1 carbon left over. The hydrogens will all be accounted for, that's 5 and 3 and 6 is 14. And we're left with an oxygen. And this has already been taken up with 4 double bond equivalents, so we've got 1 double bond left over. I'm going to say that's a C double bond O. And now we're also going to have 1 oxygen left over as well. So we've got these two pieces right here, C double bond O and an O. Those are the pieces that we're not seeing in the spectrum because there's no hydrogens connected to them. All right, so now we can put together the groups we can see and the groups we can't see. I'm going to make this ring a C6H5 ring. I'll just shorten it to that. And then we've got a CH3, and we've got 3 CH2s. In addition to that, we've got a C double bond O with no hydrogens on it, and an oxygen with no hydrogens. So these are all the pieces that we need to include. Now what I want to do is, instead of just going ahead and drawing some structures, I want to try and see if we can figure out what we've got based on a little bit of logic. Now we've got a CH3 here that's a single peak. That indicates that CH3 is likely to be, no, it's next to something that doesn't have any hydrogens on it, because one peak means zero adjacent hydrogens. Remember, the rule is this: n peaks, n minus one adjacent hydrogens on carbon atoms. So what that means is one peak, zero hydrogens on adjacent carbons. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a flyer here, and I'm going to say that the CH3 is next to the C double bond O. It really couldn't be next to anything else. If it was next to the C6H5, that would cut that, it would cut out everything else that's in the spectrum. So the CH3 must be next to the C double bond O. Now looking here, we've got three CH2s and an oxygen left over. So I've already accounted for that, and I've accounted for that. And I know that this C6H5 group is going to be on the end because it's only got one join point. So now we just need to figure out the order that these are connected in. Now let's take a look at the CH2s. If you look at if you look at what we've got here, we've got a CH2 that's got five peaks. Now if a CH2 has five peaks, what that means is there must be four adjacent hydrogens to this CH2. N peaks, N minus one hydrogens on adjacent carbons. So five peaks, four hydrogens on adjacent carbons. That tells me that I've got a CH2 that's got two CH2s next to it. And that matches up with everything, because now we've got three CH2s in a row, and that's what's been suggested by all of this. So I know that that's all together. And now I just need to figure out where this oxygen goes. So what I could do is just go ahead and put the C6H5 group in here. Put that on the end, and I'll stick the oxygen here. So all of this will match, at least for the multiplicities. But unfortunately, we can't, I don't know if that's going to be the right structure, because there's one other possibility we can manage with the C double bond O and the O. And what I can do is I can switch those and put the O here and the C double bond O here. Everything else we know is set. The three CH2s are all together. We've already figured that out. And we know the C6H5 is on the upper end. So now we just have to figure out which one of these structures is correct. Now in the previous problem that I did, I gave you a big hint. What I said was that when you've got a hydrogen that's connected to a carbon that's connected to a single bonded oxygen, that CH connected to an O will be around 4 ppm. Applying that to this structure, we look around 4 ppm, what do we see? A CH3. Since we've got a CH3 at 4 ppm, that tells us it must be the CH3 that's connected to the oxygen. So that would mean that this was indeed the correct structure. If you look at this one has a CH2 connected to an oxygen. So we know that this would not be the matching structure for this particular compound. So now what we can do is we can go ahead and label this A, B, C, D, and I will expand this out a little bit so that I can draw in the hydrogens. Okay, we'll draw in our aromatic ring down here. So we can label that too. And that would be E, F, and G. So the E, F, and G, that's all going to be these guys up here. That's our aromatic ring. The CH3 is going to be A, because that's the only CH3 in the compound. And it's connected to the oxygen, so we know it's at 4 ppm. Now we've just got to figure out these guys here. Now what I like to do is, when I'm looking at these, I will often figure out what's going on with the multiplicities. So we look at the C, and we see that this C, CH2 here, has it's going to be this one here, because this has five peaks and it's got four adjacent hydrogens. So this one's going to be C. And the other two are going to be B and D. Now this is going to be a little bit of a toss-up, but I'm going to say that this one is B and this one is D. Now, both of these groups, the C double bond O and the aromatic ring, are having an effect on these CH2s and pushing them a little bit downfield. But since the B is closer to a C double bond O, which is likely to have a bigger electronegative effect than the ring will, I'm going to go ahead and assign this one as B, and I'll assign the other one as D.